Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount is actually a collection of his sayings that he determined to make in a very profound and distinctive way that the people would never forget, that there would always be some place and some point in time where suddenly the kingdom of God had come to earth and that had been personified in the person of the Messiah, of Jesus himself, stating categorically what and who he is, as well as his authority to determine what we should do in following him if we say we are his. Because you see, there were people that were following from a distance, that they would look at him and they would question what he was saying and question who he was, but they didn't really want to be his disciple. They just followed from a distance. And sometimes when we look at the Sermon on the Mount, we look at it from a distance and we say, oh, well, that's a nice idea, and we follow it far away and we question what it might mean, and we try to say that it's something that it's not, or that we try to make it into something that he didn't mean it to be. And then there are others who came closer, who had seen his miracles, and they began to believe in what he was saying. They continued to walk and to listen carefully what he was saying because they thought, maybe this could be the person that we think he is. It might be that truth that we were looking for. And so sometimes we get a little closer to what Jesus is saying and we say, hey, that's a nice religious idea, but don't get so spiritually minded that you're no earthly good. Don't make it into something it's not. Let's just stick with the good things. Let's just incorporate the part that fits our lifestyle. Let's just take the Beatitudes. Let's just make it something that fits for our day, because after all, it was spoken a long time ago and it can't be really that applicable to today. So let's change it a little bit to make it fit. Let's make it work for us. And then there are those people who Jesus said, come up to here, come up to me. And he says it so at the very beginning, because it says, and seeing the multitudes, he saw everyone that were following from afar and following closer up. He went up unto a mountain, and when he was set, when he was ready, when he was arranged himself and was prepared to speak, his disciples came unto him. And so there are those who got close to Jesus and knew what he said. They likewise communicated it to others. But what was interesting is that if you look at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, you also know that the crowds heard what he said, and they were shocked, because he didn't say something simple. He made it very direct. He didn't say something that could be interpreted from afar. He didn't say something that could be changed or rearranged into some religious idea and made conformable to our image so that we could somehow dodge what Jesus said, because that's what the reality is today for you. You can follow from afar and pretend like you don't know what he's saying. You could come closer and interpret it in some way that makes it fit for you. Or you could do like Jesus said and obey or not. Because at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, he made it very clear. People that obey are wise. People that don't, their house will be torn down. I can't mince the words. You already know that they're there. You can read them. You can review them. He started off with a blessing to the people. Brechas. He said, blessed. And we know the Beatitudes, and we've gone through them. But then he comes to a place where he's speaking of the salt of the earth and the light of the world. And now we read in verse 16, chapter 5, as ways of people keeping track of where the scriptures are. Because a lot of times when you're in scrolls, you don't see numbers, but they're just listed there and you read through it. But we're taking this line upon line, precept upon precept, in a way that we can understand directly, as though God were speaking to you today, which he is, as though God were wanting you to understand, which he is, as though God were making it very clear what Jesus said, so that you would know to do it or not do it is your choice today. And so in verse 17, or verse 16, it says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. We've discussed how you have the light of the world in you, how you are a light, whether you like it or not, that you are casting forth some type of perspective to everyone around you, whether you say something or not. But it's interesting is that we could pretend, when we were talking about being the light, that we don't have to open our mouth. that we don't have to do anything to be a light, because we just have to be put in our proper place, as we saw in verse 16 or verse 15. And that light would shine, you know, to people, so we could be a silent witness. And that sounds good, doesn't it? It sounds like a wonderful way to not do what Jesus said. But Jesus wasn't content with allowing for their loopholes in anything that he said. So we read in verse 17, or verse 16, let your light so shine. So we are a light. We do shine. You can't help that part, because light automatically will shine, whether you know it or not, whether you admit it or not, whether you cover it or not, it's still shining. That's the point. You could put your hand over a flashlight and the flashlight's still shining. You could put a blanket over that light and the light is still shining. It doesn't quit shining just because something's covering it, or just because it's hidden in a bushel, or just because it's hidden in some other place, because the light will still shine. But he says, let your light so shine before men, so we can't cover it. We can't hide it. We have to do like he said in the previous verses, to be like a city on a hill, to be shining where he puts us, to be so that we can be seen by men. Why? That they may see your good works. Works? Whoa, wait a minute. I thought I was a light. I thought I didn't have to do anything. You don't. Your works are what's being done in you to accomplish through you as the light that you are to the world. You see, because when you are a light, you'll reveal the things around you, whether you know it or not, whether you accept it or not. You can't help but notice things that you never saw before once you're a follower of Jesus, once you know Jesus. You can't help but be aware that I see someone in need and everyone else didn't even notice and stepped on them. You can't help but reach down to that person with your hand and pick up someone who's being stepped on by someone else. You can't help but do those things that God has made you to be, as he is the beginner, the author, the finisher of our faith, because in what Jesus is saying here, your works will reveal the light that you are. Now, you may be just a simple, you know, little candle flickering in the wind, and your light may not be very bright. So your works might not be very great, you think. You see, Jesus didn't say, be a great light. He didn't say, be a spotlight. He didn't say, be any other kind of light except what you are. He said, let your light, whatever light you are, whether it be a spotlight shining, you know, as bright as you are, or whether it be a candle flickering in the wind, whether you be a LED with the cool light that you could touch, or whether you be a those lights that are, I can't think of the name of it right now, fluorescent, not the fluorescent, but the other ones, halogen, that are so hot that it'll burn if you touch them. But you are a light, so your light, whatever it may be, will shine before men, and that your works should be revealed as you do them to all men, so that one reason, and this is the only reason why you do anything, the only reason why you shine, the only reason that there is for your purpose of being a Christian, so your Father in heaven may be glorified. Because anything else is just simply you shining a light on yourself. But when you don't pay attention to what you're doing and let God do it through you because you are a light, then your Father in heaven receives the glory. So Jesus is telling us something interesting here. He's getting a little personal. He's getting a little intimate. He's saying, your light, whatever it may be, whether you are a bright light or whether you're a little light. He's already said he wants to put you in your place. You have to be in a candle holder. He already told you don't want to go start a fire. He already told you that you don't want to just shoot your light up into the sky and not be worthwhile except to draw attention to yourself. Now he's saying that your light and your works must glorify your Father in heaven. So when you're being a light, if you suddenly notice that everyone's paying attention to you, are you doing what Jesus said? Think about it for a while. Let it sink in. Take a look around you and see who's getting the glory. Is it your Father in heaven? Or is it you? Do you go out like a spotlight and try to highlight someone else? Or are your works causing people to give glory to your Father in heaven? Is your light causing people to give glory to your Father in heaven? You see, when you go out to try to illuminate someone else's sin, you're not giving glory to your Father in heaven, now are you? When you go out to claim that you're telling other people about false prophets or false teachers or some other doctrine, are you giving glory to your Father in heaven? No, you're not. You're bringing glory to yourself. You're bringing consciousness of people seeing you as the light, not giving the light back to God for His glory. Because the light in you isn't your own light. The light in you is the light of the world that shineth in the darkness. The light of the world is Jesus in you, and you can't be a light without Him. You are not the light itself, but in you, as God lives in you and accomplishes in you His purposes, is the light. So when you see that God is getting the glory for it, when you know the people are being pointed to God, when you know the people are seeing God in the things that are being done by you, then you know you're doing what Jesus said. Because if you're doing anything else, if you're taking God's glory, if you're changing the light into something you can manage like a flashlight, then you might be just using it for your own benefit. You might be accomplishing your own purpose, and you might not be doing exactly what Jesus said. Because He said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory or glorify your Father which is in heaven." Today you have to decide what Jesus said. Is it glorifying your Father in heaven? You know, and He knows. It's up to you to do what Jesus said. Thank you.